wanted to use the Jefferson Center as a model for how you can do things that resonate, things that are relevant in the community. And then I started thinking about this sort of the larger project, like what could I say to small cities anywhere in this country, or large cities, whatever, about how you create audiences for stuff that matters. And my background is I went to Navy band right out of high school, and I said, well, I just want to play guitar for a living. They said, well, we'll pay you to play guitar for a living. I said, well, that sounds awesome. I didn't know then that I had to go to boot camp and do all the other things that the Navy had, but I did do that. And so my whole life has been about trying to create an audience for what I do, to create a market for what I do. So I'm going to start my PowerPoint with the most obvious statement that will be made today. Great art deserves an audience, obviously, right? We all know that. So as I was working through these ideas, of course, I had that risk. I thought, well, this is like a new idea, and I think I can help in this category. And I thought, well, and then you have that fear, of course, that everything you're saying is so patently obvious that everybody in the audience is going to go, yeah, of course, great art deserves an audience. But what I'm going to talk about is how do you get there? How do you create a model for sustainability in the arts that's maybe different than how we're usually thinking about the arts? So, and I guess the main message is that intent is not enough. The management of intent is equally important. So let's think about that for a second. You know, like, I'm in my master's degree program at Manhattan School of Music, learning to play the guitar. My teacher says, you know, it's about why you're choosing to play this. It's going to change whether or not you're successful at it. And he was right in terms of my ability to play the guitar, but not necessarily right in terms of my ability to develop a market for what I do. And that's the second step. How do you have great intent but manage that intent in a way that supports the quality of the intent? So my next thought was that commercial success in the arts stems from the understanding that creating art and presenting art are both equally challenging. They're both really, really hard. And maybe more importantly is that you don't sour the first by doing the second. Right? I'm a guitar player, and I just love it. Like the story of the jazz guitar player sits in this room in New York City out in Brooklyn, and he practices for 14 hours a day, and he's like, and he really does become the most important, guitar player in the world. He's just like the most killing player ever. But no one calls him because he hasn't left his apartment in 6 years, you know? He hasn't gone out into the community and connected with people who can help him create a market for what he does, and therefore he hasn't created a market for what he does. And I think this model is similar both in terms of an individual musician or individual artist, but I think it's also similar in terms of the institutions or venues that that exist in the world that should be presenting this great art. In my case, it's Jefferson Center. It's a 110,000 square foot historic high school that was converted into a performance space and nonprofit rental space, short term and long term. And of course, we have a music lab there, which I'll speak about a little bit later. So it's about sustainability in the arts, about building relevance for the product that you have, and about that really beautiful place where commerce and art meet, and what happens in that zone, and what Ed Walker mentioned a little bit about that yesterday. I want to say very quickly that based on what I've seen after a year at Jefferson Center, there is no fundamental difference between the nonprofit sector and the for-profit sector. I'm running a business like everyone else is running a business. It has all the same concerns, it has all the same challenges, it has all the same issues. Yes, anyone in this room, and I would encourage you to do so, can write a check to Jefferson Center and get a tax benefit for doing so. So that most really important side of what we do is different than a for-profit business, but in terms of running the business, it's exactly the same thing. We're in the business of creating a market for what we think has the deepest impact. And our feedback is the amount of support we get through the donations or ticket sales or grant income or wherever those revenues might come from. But it's the same model. It's the same model for individuals who are hoping to build a life in the arts and the same model for institutions that are hoping to build that model. So that brought me to the same level of character and discipline that it took to create the art can be used to find venues to display the art. And this is one of those moments I'm hoping that doesn't seem patently obvious, but that is really the message, isn't it? Like when a student is in my jazz ensemble at 7:15 every morning at Patrick Henry High School, I don't personally care whether that student goes out and becomes a great jazz guitar player, a great saxophone player. I mean, I think it's cool if they decide to do that, and I'll help them along that path, but what matters to me is the level of character that they're developing through being engaged in something that matters to them. It's the discipline of learning. It's the engagement. It's how do you take something you care a lot about and then enter into a transaction. I often think that Manhattan School of Music, when I was there, actually missed out on a whole side of what we should have been learning. There are two things that should have been happening at Manhattan School of Music, two classes. And if they ever ask me to come back and create them, I'll do it. It would be awesome. The first one is, I think, they should have rented out a gym at Columbia University and took us on a bus over to Columbia University, actually maybe ride around for 8 hours first, and then drop us off at Columbia University in a gym, and you take all the gear out of a truck, and you load it into this gym, and you set it up, and then you get someone just off the street who has never run sound before. Sorry to the sound guys, I don't mean you, I just meant in general. And you have someone sit behind the board, and you do an hour and a half concert, and then you load all of that stuff back into the truck, and you get back in the bus, and you ride around for 8 hours, and you unload all that stuff back into it. I mean, that has actually the reality of a working musician, of many working musicians. The second class is, I thought, well, let's go to NYU and get the theater students to be on one side of a phone call, and the musicians at Manhattan School of Music would be on the other. And the theater folks are playing the part of a bride that wants to hire a band for a wedding, right? You'd be like, I mean, that would be awesome, right? Like, and then you have to like book this gig, and you know, are you able to play, you know, a Kenny G song for my while I'm walking down the aisle? Do you know, are you going to be able to play the electric slide like it sounds on the recording? You know, I mean, that's actually that transactional moment, the reality for musicians about what it's going to take to make a living at this thing, that's what I really think should be talked about. So the intent is right. You want the intent to be right. You want the art to be right. You want it to be impactful. You want it to be relevant. But managing that relevance is really, really important. The same level of character and discipline that it took to create that art can be used to manage the venues where that art happens. So again, it's the same model of what I'm doing. I'm managing a venue, and I want the management of that venue to be beyond reproach. I want it to be the most highest achieving organization or company in the Valley or in this country. I want it to be as good as it possibly can be, because my thought is I have this responsibility to multiple stakeholders in what Jefferson Center is. In our case, it's 5,000 alumni of the high school itself. It's the thousands of people who donate to what we do. It's the musicians that depend on the fact that we program great art and great music and they come through and perform there. It's the staff, it's the nonprofit tenants who rent from us and are afforded rates for their rentals that allow them to focus their resources on the programming that they do. So I'm thinking about what I do at Jefferson Center the same way I'm thinking about my own personal jazz career. I'm happy to say that the Jefferson Center thing's going a lot better than the personal jazz career. And that might be just a function of market, and we can talk a little bit about that. Now, so that got me to a quadrant. Well, this is, wait, you should be texting in a second that the big idea was Cyrus's quadrant. So I can hide that, right? All right, so check this out. Now, there's limited depth and depth and strong management and weak management, okay? Right, like, and the letters don't really mean like that's an A student, that's a B student. I would think that you would want to be an A, right? You'd want to be doing something that's really deep, but you'd also want to be able to manage it really, really strongly, okay? So as a test case for this, sort of like a model for what this could look like, I'm going to take you through a couple things here, and I'm hoping, again, this is the takeaway. So again, the text should be Cyrus's quadrant. Because I think I could write a book about this on that iPad. That's what I'm thinking. All right, so now what I'm about to do could take the oxygen out of this room, and I want to say sorry to Theaster and sorry to Nikki, because this could really do it, but they might be fans, so we'll see how it goes. Shame to like it. Kind of funny because he does hold the world record for the longest note ever played. Nobody said anything about it. It was also the worst note ever played. Yeah. The longest and worst note all at once. Now, there's this big thing in the jazz community, right? Like, you gotta hate Kenny G, and Pat Metheny has written some things. A lot of people have written some things about Kenny G. Here's what we should know about Kenny G, though. Dude had a business plan, right? That's all. Dude had a business plan. Well, we can't hate Kenny G for that. However, we do sort of, in a sense, yearn for a greater understanding about great jazz and what it could mean to a student's life or to your life or to, you know, to this country's life. And so, in yearning for that, I don't think hating Kenny G helps us. It definitely didn't hurt him. Right? I mean, the dude sold a lot of records. His Christmas record, Miracle, is the top-selling instrumental holiday record of all time. He's the 25th highest-selling recording artist of all time. Dude had a business plan, and he followed it, right? So where does Kenny G come on our quadrant of depth?
B.
Yeah, I think he's a B. Right, now, it's not really a conversation about aesthetics. I mean, Kenny G played some stuff that mattered to a lot of people, you know? Like, he was the guy that answered the phone and said, yeah, I'll play this song at your wedding, and Songbird is like at every wedding ever, right? Like in the 80s, if you went to a wedding, Songbird, that song you were hearing, was the song that a lot of people walked down the aisle to. So it does mean a lot to people. So again, I'm not necessarily saying that it's not important. I'm just saying we might learn something about supporting another model or another kind of depth that might change how we think about what we do. All right, so here's something else. Now, this is really night music. It seems weird to listen to Billie Holiday before 10, but we should.
That sparkle in your eyes is gone. Your smile is just a careless yawn. You're breaking my heart. You've changed. You've changed. Your kisses now are so blasé.
I mean, you know, like, first of all, what a cool thing, because if you don't have that record, you'll probably buy it now. I mean, that record's like, but it's like you don't want the phone call after midnight, like Nikki's. I think you don't want to listen to this until after midnight. You know, it's like that's when the whole thing changes. So, I mean, you guys probably know something about Billie Holiday's life. You probably know something about her music. So this isn't exactly fair. But where does Billie Holiday come down personally as an artist into this quadrant? Probably nowhere.
C.
But in a sense, we would think C, right? She didn't manage her own personal life in a way that matched the beauty with which she was creating the art that she did. And so we lost her much earlier than we should have, as we do many great artists and musicians. So again, what we think about how an individual artist creates their life is exactly how we think about how an institution should create its life and how it should continue to be relevant and have a business plan that works. And again, you're not souring the art by entering into a transaction. If you care about the art that much, develop a marketing plan for it. Care about the art enough that you want it to be heard by people. There's this weird catch-22, I'll tell you a little story, right? Take a saxophone player, he's in a club in Brooklyn, and he's you know, kind of avant-garde, you know, he's way out playing this stuff. There's like seven people there who are just crazy about this guy. And he's killing it. I mean, it's way, way out. I mean, you know, I have a master's in jazz. I wouldn't necessarily sit down and listen to it, right? Way, way out. So someone, one of the seven people that are there, come up to him and say, listen, man, I just want you to know that was exceptional. And the saxophone player says, how would you know? Right? Right? Like, I want to be loved for what I do. And I want it to have mass appeal. And I want people to buy it. But I'm so hip that there's no way people can possibly understand what I do, right? That's a terrible catch-22 to be in. If what you care about is being so unique that no one understands you, well, congratulations. You probably will end up getting that. If what you say is, I care so much about what I do, and I think it's so interesting that I will do anything I need to make sure as many possible people hear this as I can find. I mean, that's the model that I guess I'm thinking about constantly. What about, all right, let's think about in terms of institutions. What are some institutions that would fit in strong management and depth? I mean, we think of that. Yeah, Jeff. Oh, thank you. What about? I mean, I'm just going to do some jazz at Lincoln Center, right? I mean, we think about an institution that's been wildly successful, that also creates and promotes great music. You know, whatever you think about Wynton Marsalis, I don't think is really. I mean, the institution itself is doing important work, and they're doing it in a sustainable way. How about something not music related? What about Occupy Wall Street? Where would they be in this? Yeah, it depends on who you are and what you're thinking, right? So they would say that this is the new model, right? That they're crowdsourcing incredibly great management because it's all of the voices being heard at once that make it important, and that if they tried to manage it, it would actually lose value. So that's another new model that I probably need to process in my own brain and figure out, you know, where that would fit. So anyway, really quick, I want to talk to you about Jefferson Center and sort of what our model is for how we're doing this and how we're connecting kids. We know that if we want an audience for what we do, we have to educate kids about what great music is. That makes sense, right? So I worked in the Roanoke City Schools for 3 years, got the VH1 Save the Music grant for some kids, which was great. You know, you can go to 11 of the 17 elementary schools in this city and see fourth and fifth graders playing violins and trumpets and drums and pianos. How about a round for that? Yeah. Again, we know that arts education does it because it's about connecting a kid to something that helps them build discipline and build meaning in their life and all that. But we also know that that it allows them to learn about what great art is, that they come in contact with beauty. Beautiful thing about arts education is it's that place where you can still talk about God. It's that place you can still talk about spirit. It's that place you can still talk about soul, which is awesome. So when I asked my some of you probably heard this if you came to a show at Jefferson Center, but I asked my jazz ensemble to define the word soul for me, you know, because you can talk about soul in a jazz ensemble in our class. And so they wrote, what would James Brown do, you know? But that's what soul was for them. I was like, yes, I can stop teaching now. Everything's, you know, I've done everything I needed to do. But the model at Jefferson Center is really about the thought that lifemanship is more important than musicianship. It's the skills that you glean from being engaged in something that matters that creates the person that you are. You know, some of my best relationships in my life have been created through the fact that I was a teacher of someone who wanted to learn more about their life. So, you know, people who want to learn more about their lives through being engaged in something artistic. And so the music lab does this beautiful thing. It's, you know, housed at Jefferson Center, and it connects kids to the artists that come there. So Del McCurry, who's playing tonight, you should definitely get a ticket, went to the music lab last year along with the Dirty Dozen Brass Band and did a master class for kids. So they sat there amongst like the heroes. Maceo Parker, who was James Brown's best saxophone player for all of those recordings you ever heard, went to the music lab and hung out with hip-hop kids. Now our job is to make sure that those hip-hop kids know who Maceo Parker is, because they don't. I mean, they're building a track in Logic that is based on James Brown's beats, but they may not know who Maceo Parker is. So this is their chance to be upfront and personal, right on somebody who is a leader in their field of what they do, both in terms of character and in terms of art. And that's the model. So obviously, if you're from here, come see us. If you're not from here, come tonight, see Del McCurry. And check out what we're doing at Jefferson Center. I think it's a very, very special place. And because it's so special, I have a very deep interest in making sure that it's managed incredibly well. This is our logo for the music lab, and we're gonna play a video that we created. It's gonna be a PSA that's going on TV now. And again, my thought is you've got to do a PSA that looks like something you can see promoting an iPad. You have to do a PSA that looks like, I'm serious, you gotta do something that looks so incredible because it's that important. The iPod's important, I get that, but it has market share. People are gonna buy those, right? So this is our attempt at making sure that we present ourselves as well as any other product in the world. Yeah.
moving, but they ain't saying nothing. So I grab the mic right, and you know I get it jumping. You can call me what you want, you can think that I'm ugly, but Malik Sims hot, you just warm like a Snuggie. You can call it what you want, you can think that I'm ugly, but Malik Sims hot, you just warm like a Snuggie. If they thinking that they hot, and you know they really not, let me see you get a rock, hit them with a slingshot. If they thinking that they hot, and you know they really not, let me see you get a rock, hit them with a slingshot.
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 Hit them with a slingshot.